Hi there, everybody. I'm just waiting on David, I think. It's the last person I'm waiting to tune in. So thanks for your patience.
Are you referring to David, me?
Very same. The David Ricciardo.
Okay, great.
There he
Yeah,
is.
I was digging that intro. Thank you. I'm
Oh, sorry. My panel only shows a couple of floating heads, so I didn't see you there. Well, let me change this a little bit. Let me pin my video. Okay, welcome everybody. Can everybody hear me and see me? Things are sounding good.
Yes. Yeah.
Welcome to this lecture recital. I'd like to start off by thanking my committee members, Dave Ricciero, Carter Pan, Ben Teitelbaum, and of course, Eric Eckert and Gary Lewis, for all of your support and guidance through this and all the projects so far and beyond. Also, I just mentioned that coincidentally, it's Jewish High Holiday. And I promise I didn't schedule this recital specifically for that, but happy Passover if there's any observing folks. Klezmer music is steeped in tradition while existing both as a result and agent of a cultural adaptation and aesthetic fusion. Comprised of Gypsy, Romanian, Ukrainian, Greek, Bulgar, Russian, and American aesthetics and traditions, adapted an application from traditional wedding ceremonies in Eastern Europe to cafes and bars in the US, and both inspired and inspired by American jazz, rock and roll, popular, and European classical genres, positioning what klezmer is a really difficult concept. So, to arrive at an understanding of klezmer performance practice, this project will use a newly commissioned work for solo cello by Colorado composer Conor Abbott Brown, entitled The Century Tune, as a lens through which to consider relevant historical elements and unique performance techniques of klezmer. As a result, I endeavor to approach the variety of klezmer techniques presented in the Century Tune intentionally, if not authentically, while grappling with authenticity means in the context of klezmer. To help get to this point, I've taken a deep dive into Jewish history and klezmer tradition, taken private lessons with klezmer musicians Max Wolpert, Steve Greenman, and Alicia Svigals, and have worked closely with Connor in the preparation of the Century Tune. To preface the commission project, I'll say that I definitely did not begin with a specific interest in klezmer music. In August 2019, I had conversations with composer friends with the intention of commissioning original music for solo cello. The concept involved approaching composers who had not yet written for the solo cello genre and whose compositional practice is informed by any given folk tradition. The mission of the project is therefore to enrich the solo cello repertory by engaging composers who may or may not identify with the concept of being a composer, but perhaps conceive of music in aural or oral traditions, graphically, through Western notation, or whatever. So far, the results include works for solo cello by Theodosia Roussos, a vocalist, oboist, and composer whose work is often inspired by her Greek ancestry, and Conor Abbott Brown, a clarinetist and composer whose work is inspired by Jewish music and klezmer tradition. The Century Tune is a 10-part piece for solo cello and pre-recorded cello ensemble, and I pre-recorded all 9 parts myself with my very limited technology. Brown described the Century Tune as Steve Reich meets klezmer. In a style I would later learn to be characteristic of klezmer music, the piece is effectively a medley of related but contrasting elements. The first half is characterized by a minimalist, rhythmic, and harmonic aesthetic, which transitions seamlessly into a Jewish Jacques dance form. Other klezmer ingredients include traditional harmonic modes and ornamentation, including trills, pitch bends, and creche. When this commission project originally came about, the idea was for Connor and I to get together in person and work on some of the ornamentation together, meet up in a practice room, and he would play ornamentation, and I would learn how to do that just in person. Of course, COVID-19 meant that that was less possible, and so Connor recommended that I take a deep dive into learning about Jewish aesthetic myself, and that turned out to be the foundation for this project. Before diving into some history, let's get the sound of klezmer in our ears and hearts, in addition to the backing tracks we heard as not backing tracks, the background music when you arrived. Here is a traditional Jacques performed by the Abe Schwartz Orchestra from the early 20th century. Thank you. that tune later on and talk about some of the details, so don't worry. Jewish musical tradition features music for listening and for dancing, and often occupies a utilitarian role for both religious functions or wedding ceremonies. Klezmer music represents a secular folk tradition, and for the majority of its history existed both on the fringe of official culture, but also intertwined into the daily lives of Jewish people. Prior to the advent of wax cylinder and phonograph recording technology, Klezmer traditions were transmitted orally. Therefore, there really is scarce tangible information about the repertoire, instruments, musicians, or even applications of this music prior to the 19th century. By the late 18th century, Jews migrated from established communities in Western and Central Europe, including Spain, Portugal, France, to Eastern territories. This new territory to which they were restricted, referred to as the Pale of the Settlement, includes land located in contemporary Poland, Romania, Ukraine, Belarus, and Lithuania, and stretches from the Baltic to the Black Seas. Naturally, they brought along their cultural and musical practices, which were more or less put up with by Russian czars and other noble people. While the geography of the Jewish culture experienced division, a rift within the social fabric of Jewish life emerged. Beginning in the 1770s, Moses Mendelssohn's Enlightenment movement, known as Haskalah, encouraged Jews to adopt the sociocultural traits of the non-Jewish society surrounding them, while also readjusting their own religious rituals to accommodate those new social adaptations. Widely considered as the Jewish version of the Age of Enlightenment, Haskalah promoted rationalism, liberalism, and individualism. This movement, in addition to later socialist and nationalist trends, would begin to loosen the once narrow social and religious restrictions within the Jewish community. So entertainment, without ties to religious or ritual events, slowly began in increasing numbers of Jewish communities. At a similar moment in history, Hasidism, a spiritual revival movement led by Baal Shem Tov, encouraged Jews to express their piety through the ecstatic fervor of music and dance, a phenomenon regarded as previously impermissible. The effects of Hasidism meant the inclusion of wordless songs, or nagun, into everyday events. Hasidim sang these melodies with an intense urgency, hoping to ascend to higher realms through their music. Also, in the northern territories, the intellectual Misadim, under the leadership of Vilagon, resisted the rise of Hasidism and emphasized disciplined scholarship over music and dance. A confluence of social, industrial, and religious revolutions would contribute to the transformation of traditional Jewish life, and Klezmerim, in the midst of it all, found both a necessity and agency to adapt. We can observe the gradual elevation of secular and folk traditions within a previously rigid religious culture, and while religious music would maintain its dominance and continue to influence these secular musicians, it's perhaps within this context that Klezmer first found its footing. The term klezmer emerged between the 16th and 18th centuries in Europe and replaced older terms for clown or laits. Klezmer referred initially to the musical instruments themselves and developed into a derogatory term for the musicians who played those instruments later on. The term comes from a combination of Hebrew words, klei, meaning tools, utensils, or instruments of, and zamer, or melody, which leads us to klezmer, or literally instruments of music. We can also think of this as a term for those people who played those instruments professionally. So in the 19th century, the terms klezmer and klezmerim referred not to a genre of music, but to individual performers and their instruments. An effective interpretation of these terms would be the klezmer's music, the music that klezmerim played, as the predecessor to the present-day understanding of klezmer music, the sort of catch-all term for a genre and the performers of that genre. This distinction allows us to consider the multiplicity of musical genres that klezmerim played throughout the 19th century and beyond, and how this would influence music into the 20th and 21st centuries. In the early 20th century in the US, klezmer and klezmerim carried a pejorative connotation that referred to traditions of old Europe and was used primarily by musicians as a derogatory reference to those whom they felt couldn't adapt to the changing demands of the music scene. In 19th century Europe, klezmerim were considered fringe members of society. Why? I will suggest that this identity is a result of their association with secular music, as well as international non-Jewish influences. Jonathan Friedman notes, the music we now call klezmer originally bore a thoroughly marginal, almost subversive relation to the traditional world of Eastern European Jewry in which it originated. The klezmerim were liminal characters, or more properly, quintessential insider-outsiders, central to the life of the community, but existing in every possible way on its fringes. It's easy to imagine klezmerim frequenting pubs that hosted any variety of international personalities and their musical traditions. Klezmerim traveled frequently, associated with other marginalized groups such as the Gypsies, with a capital G, and played music that was outside of the liturgical tradition. I can't help but summarize all of this by thinking that they were 19th century Jewish rock stars. I think that an understanding of who klezmerim were, or at least how they were viewed by Jewish society, directly contributes to our knowledge of what klezmer music is, where it comes from, and maybe how it should sound. Besides the folks who played it, what makes klezmer music klezmer? Klezmer music exists at an intersection of secular and religious traditions. As we'll see in more detail later, klezmerim provided music for Jewish and non-Jewish wedding ceremonies and other events, necessarily performing non-Jewish and almost certainly not sacred music to fit any given occasion. It's no surprise then that Gypsy, Greek, Bulgar, Russian, and beyond musics are prominent components of the klezmer harmonies and melodies, but also the other way around. Klezmerim were heavily influenced by sacred liturgical modes and the vocal techniques commonplace with cantors. Liturgical modes were utilized by cantors to identify different types of prayers and to connect those prayers to a given time of year in which they are performed. Modes specific to the Ashkenazic communities of Eastern Europe include the Ava Rabba, Magin Avat, and Adonai Moloch, which we will see in the context of the century tune later. The titles of these modes are derived from the first words of their respective prayers. Additionally, musical ornamentation techniques have made their way into instrumental performance, may find their origin in cantorial singing and recitation. Krex is an instrumental technique that is reminiscent of groaning, wailing, or weeping. A shock imitates the sound of laughter. A knietch is inspired by a sob-like catch that often occurs at the end of cantorial phrases or when the cantor changes vocal registers. By the mid-18th century at least, klezmerim were synonymous with wedding festivals. Klezmer music was used to highlight almost every aspect of the wedding ritual. An admixture of the sad and gleeful music accompanied every ritual act, from the bride's dressing, to the procession, to the joyous dancing afterwards, and sometimes even the consummation of the marriage itself from outside the bedroom window. This is an image of an early 20th century wedding, and it looks chaotic, but if you look closely, we can see a klezmerim playing violin and probably other band members in the corner. Each dance had a particular function within a traditional wedding. The klezmerim's rhythms were essential elements to fulfill the mitzvah, or religious duty, of making the wedding a joyous occasion for both the bride and the groom. Specific dances were played for members of the family and guests. In addition to dance rituals, klezmerim provided a variety of emotional experiences. As noted previously, there was a religious duty to play music that would contribute to a joyous event. However, klezmerim also contributed music that depicted the challenges associated with marriage. A wedding meant that the bride was leaving one family to join another, transitioning from her role as daughter to wife and mother. As the majority of weddings prior to the 20th century were arranged, maybe the bride was not particularly enthusiastic about her circumstance. Any marriage is destined to possess some kind of challenge or another, and so klezmerim may have provided music that foreshadowed impending difficulties. In addition to musical components, parodic commentary was offered by the ceremonial figure of the bodchen, or master of ceremonies cum wedding jester, who worked alongside the klezmerim and in some cases was one of them. The bodchen's role was frequently to bring the obscene, the scatological, the gender bending into his communal celebration, to invoke, mimic, or summon the disasters that are to beset the married couple as they move into their new life together. Was this another factor that contributed to klezmerim's aura of disrepute? Integral to the wedding ceremony, the klezmerim were also marginal, or rather brought the marginal, the forbidden, the taboo, into this otherwise community-affirming ceremony in a somewhat safely packaged guise. This dual function extended to their place in the community itself. in which they existed as a semi-autonomous guild, a licensed band of somewhat disreputable insider outsiders who passed on musical training, trade secrets, and shtick from one generation to the next. Klezmerim were also commonplace at non-Jewish wedding ceremonies. As Jewish music was not appropriate at non-Jewish weddings, Klezmerim had to develop a flexible repertoire to fit the occasion. Specific wedding music would likely depend upon the request of the wedding party, their economic status, their geographic region. Peasantry may have expected dances such as the polka, mazurka, or the horpak of Bohemian, Polish, and Ukrainian origins, respectively. Landowners, nobility, and members of the bourgeoisie may have demanded a more diverse repertoire of the klezmerim. This may have included Western classical works, as well as waltzes and quadrilles. They were expected to also infuse regional folk melodies, popular street songs, religious hymns, ballads, and whatever else into their already robust repertoire. Outside of the ceremonies and celebrations, klezmerim could be found playing at community market days, at fairs and in wine cellars, cafes during the summer season, and spas or resorts. It was also possible to find work in the theater or even with a circus or carnival. I think I'm on the wrong slide here. There we go. One of the most tangible components that contributed to the aesthetic of klezmer was the development of Yiddish theater in Romania in the 1870s. This was theater developed by Jews for Jews, and therefore often was a showcase for Jewish music. However, in line with the interactive nature of klezmerim with non-Jewish cultures and musical styles, musicologist Mark Slobin contributes the following anecdote about Abraham Goldfaden, largely considered a foundational figure of Yiddish theater. When auditioning prospective actors or singers for his company, Goldfaden would require an applicant to sing a song of his choice, regardless of origin, be it Yiddish, operatic, sacred, or secular. Unbeknownst to the auditionee, Goldfaden's assistant would be seated in a corner of the room, copying the words and music to the songs. If the singer were chosen, he and his song were both included in the show, simultaneously expanding the musical mosaic of the play and creating a tight association between the song and the singer. Of course, if the singer wasn't chosen, at least Goldfaden had a new piece of music. The effects of this inclination are multiplicitous. Goldfaden provided his actors, musicians, and audience with a robust musical education by introducing Jews to non-Jewish art and vice versa. Songs included in Goldfaden's theater's productions became the definitive version of that song, and through prominent performances and tours, often eclipse other variations of that song. Additionally, this anecdote demonstrates an inclination to embrace and incorporate non-Jewish music within Jewish productions. The sheer quantity of repertoire that klezmerim may have had available to them for any given occasion is pretty amazing. It is also worth considering that these musicians perform primarily without notated sheet music. The flexibility afforded by oral musical traditions allows us to surmise that non-Jewish music would influence the repertoire and the performance of Jewish music, and vice versa. Klezmerim then represented an intersection of affect and effect, influencer and influenced, give and take. Klezmer music embraces a foundation of sacred liturgical elements and techniques while acting as a sponge, both out of necessity and interest, to seemingly all other musical elements with which it interacts. 19th century klezmer bands were typically led by violinists. Other traditional klezmer instruments include the hammered dulcimer, straw fiddle, harmonica, bohemian flute, etc. By the 1920s, Jewish dance music instrumentation had fallen more in line with typical American vaudeville or concert bands. What the violin and clarinet have in common. In the 20th century, clarinet became the primary instrument in klezmer. The prevalence of both the clarinet and violin could be due to their relative availability, affordability, and transportability, but perhaps more importantly, what the violin and clarinet have in common and what makes them the quintessential instruments of klezmer are their ability to mimic the human voice. Both instruments are pitched closely to the voice, and in the hands of a skilled klezmer musician, both can produce krechen, shocks, and knetchen, the achy, bent, and cut-off notes derived from the synagogue tradition of the cantor, which we often hear as the laughing and crying quality of klezmer. This is an essence of klezmer ornamentation and is arguably the single most important characteristic of klezmer, both musically and in terms of its Jewishness. When I heard this account, I couldn't help but think of the cello, which is so often closely associated with the human voice. Because of the emotional valence of correction and their delivery from a religious authoritative figure, these techniques are preeminent features of klezmer music. On string music, they are typically produced by slapping the pinky finger to stop the string from vibrating while simultaneously accelerating the bow speed. The effect is a kind of vocal pop reminiscent of a cantor's moaning effect. On cello, it sounds kind of like this. With that background of what correction are and what they represent, let's listen to a few examples. The first I'll play is a solo from Alicia Svigals, and the second is from David Krakauer. They are a bit short, so I apologize in advance for the abrupt cutoff. I'll also say that we will hear other kinds of ornamentation in both solos, but we're listening for that cutoff, aching sound of the correction. Let's go back to both those later. They're both so good, but moving on. Though Jews began immigrating to the United States as early as the 1820s, mass immigration from Eastern and Southern Europe, European territories, occurred between 1880 and 1924. Impelled by economic hardship, persecution, and the great social and political upheavals of the 19th century, millions of Europe's Jews left their towns and villages and embarked on the arduous journey to the Golden Land, or Golden Medine, of America. The vast majority arrived on the Eastern Seaboard, and specifically New York City, where they clustered in downtown districts. In the period of a few decades, a veritable petri dish of musical backgrounds and customs was erected in New York City. Jews blended with American culture and sought to shed their old world religious traditions. Rather than primarily providing music for weddings, they played at cafes, bars, and restaurants. Those who could read music played in vaudeville orchestras, movie theaters, and the pit orchestras of the Yiddish theater. Others, as we will see, became recording stars. Three remarkable klezmer clarinetists that arrived in the U.S. in the early 20th century include Harry Condal, Dave Taras, and Nuftul Brandwein. Their intersecting paths represent a nevertheless divergent musical identities in the Golden Land that contributes to our sense of what klezmerim were up to in the 20th century. Though Harry Condal arrived in the United States in 1905, it wasn't until 1917 they began a career performing and recording Jewish music. Prior to 1917, Condal was engaged in American vaudeville orchestras, played with John Philip Sousa's band in Philadelphia, and led a dance band in Atlantic City. It's entirely possible that Condal was interested in escaping his old world traditions, but it's also equally as likely that he was just interacting with whatever was available around him. Dave Taras, born in 1895, immigrated to the U.S. in 1921. Though a descendant of a notable musical family in Eastern Europe, and having played in Tsar Nikolai's military band, Taras reportedly did not consider the possibility of making a living as a musician in the U.S. He said, "I thought that in America, to be a musician, one has to have, he has to be something. I didn't think that I'm good enough to be a musician." Nevertheless, Taras has since come to occupy a unique place in American klezmer music as the model for several generations of American-born Jewish clarinetists due to his elegant, clean, and precise manner of performance, as well as his numerous compositions. It's clear that Taras found his footing in the U.S. after all. Perhaps the most colorful character of these three notable clarinetists, Nuftul Brandwein, arrived in the United States in 1913, and, unlike Condal and Taras, quickly established himself as a well-known performer in the Jewish musical community. Aside from being a featured recording artist for Columbia Records, Brandvine occupied a quasi-legendary artist persona. Stories of Brandvine performing wearing only an Uncle Sam costume crafted entirely from Christmas tree lights and very nearly electrocuting himself with his own sweat. His association as being a preferred performer at Brooklyn's notorious Murder Incorporated, the organized and violent enforcement branch of the Italian and Jewish mobs, and his reputation of playing with his back to his audience so that perceptive concertgoers wouldn't steal his unique fingering techniques, all contribute to the image of an artist out of time. Indeed, Brandvine wouldn't be out of place in 21st century avant-garde performance circles. We heard recordings from all three clarinetists during the intro tracks when you arrived. An important ingredient that Condell, Terrace, and Brandvine have in common is their occupation with recorded music. The peak years of immigration coincided with the early growth of the recording industry. The vast immigrant populations beckoned as valuable markets for ethnic recordings, or nostalgic evocations of their homelands. Aside from a commercial opportunity for new immigrant musicians in the United States, these 78 RPM records would serve as 3-minute musical Rosetta Stones, providing preceding generations of klezmer players a window into the musical traditions of a bygone era. Let's talk about the limitations imposed by recording technology, like duration and instrumentation. Songs that were formerly performed in continuous 20-minute suites for dancing at weddings and celebrations were now sold in the form of 78 RPM platters that contained 3 minutes of music per side and were played in private living rooms. Some of the earliest acoustic recording processes, in which musicians played directly into a horn rather than a microphone, did not favor instruments with a gentle timbre such as violin, flute, or the hammer dulcimer, and so brass instruments and the piano became prevalent. In a similar manner to the codification of folk tunes in Goldfaden's Yiddish theater in the 1870s, klezmer repertoire that existed for generations as an oral tradition was now available in a fixed, recorded medium. The variation within melodies and musical structures would undoubtedly occur in future generations. A standard of original tunes, the right way to play klezmer, was now available. With the history of Jewish culture, klezmerim, ornamentation, instrumentation in mind, let's now take a look at Conor Abbott Brown's The Century Tune. Key klezmer ingredients include a jacque dance form, sacred Ashkenazic modes, and ornamentation including trills, pitch bends, and correction. A jacque is a slow Romanian-style piece in triple meter, usually written in 3/8, whose rhythm is distinctive because of the lack of the second beat. Brown's The Century Tune mirrors this pattern almost identically, though in a 3/4 pattern rather than a 3/8. I think this is just a convenient way due to some rhythmic complexity in the first cello part. An elusive, less quantifiable, but nevertheless important ingredient of jacque rhythm is a condensed third beat that leads to a perceptively stressed downbeat. This has been described to me as something between an 11/16 and a 10/16 measure that is also malleable depending on the melodic content. With all that in mind, let's revisit Abe Schwartz's jacque from the beginning of the presentation. That due to the very limited recording technology available to me, I was not really able to consider the condensed third beat in the rhythmic parts, but was able to consider that in the melodic part. And you'll hear that with some of my condensed rhythmic approaches. Three modes present in the Century Tune includes modes that are specifically characteristic of Ashkenazic and other Eastern European music. And they include the Ava Rabba, Mishra Berach, and Adonai Moloch. Ava Rabba is often known as Phrygish among klezmer musicians, and is likely derived from the Greek term Phrygian. Though Phrygian refers to a mode with a half set between the fifth and sixth scale degrees, Frege's features a major third scale degree, which creates an interval of an augmented second between scale degrees 2 and 3. The Frege's seventh scale degree may be major or minor, depending on the melody and the context. It sounds like this. Mishra Barak, also known as the Ukrainian Dorian scale, is a mode characterized by an augmented second between the third and the fourth scale degrees. It sounds like this. Adonai Moloch is essentially a major scale, except the seventh note is supposed to be minor or a whole step below the tonic, though most examples of Adonai Moloch actually treat the seventh as a major or raised. Again, this is largely because these modes are dependent on their context. That sounds like this with the flat, and with the raised. The opening material of Brown's Jacques tune includes these ingredients characteristic of Abba Rabba: a major tonic, minor subdominant, and minor seventh chords. Additionally, the riff that makes up the first half of the piece hints at Abba Rabba with a flat 2, D flat, and a flat 6, A flat. You can track the specific ingredients of these modes with the circled notes in the printed melodies, and I will play them if you want to keep track of the circled notes. Here's Abba Rabba. And Mishra Barak. And could this be the raised seventh from the Adonai Moloch? Klezmer violinist Alicia Fiegals describes two primary forms of correction in an online masterclass: one that mirrors the vocal techniques described at length previously, and a subtle secondary version that serves a more melodic function. The second version lacks the same kind of percussive quality as the first, but nevertheless is characterized by a vocal popping sound. Conor Abbott Brown utilizes both versions in Century Tune. Percussive correction are notated with an X note head, as in the first image, while the melodic correction are included as 16th note triplets with a staccato marking, as in measure 129. Other relevant ornaments included in the Century Tune include pitch bends, trills, and grace notes. The former two ingredients remain mostly unnotated, while the latter is a primary characteristic of the first 87 measures of the work. The grace notes kind of serve as a pedal tone and is similar to certain kind of bagpipe music. In Klezmer tradition, trills exist as a quarter tone undulation combined with a wide vibrato, like this. Pitch bends are in effect executed with both right and left hands, in which the left dips roughly a quarter tone below and then back to the given pitch, while the bow simultaneously lessens and reapplies its weight contact with the string. All of these are intended to mirror vocal techniques, and so that's my approach when performing this piece. Now for the Steve Reich part, which we did not really talk about in this presentation, all I will say is that there is effectively an additive riff that's built in the first part of the piece that sounds like... does incorporate some of the modes we previously discussed. This riff is then divided between cellos 1 through 5, and included with that are syncopated harmonic sustained notes to highlight harmonic shifts. I'll say this was a real challenge recording, aligning each of these rhythmic parts exactly with each other. I entered this project with several premeditated concerns and questions. What does it mean for me as a non-Jewish person to commission, if only inadvertently, and perform music inspired by Jewish traditions? How can I approach this responsibly and effectively? At what point do I risk veering into cultural appropriation? And what steps can I take to avoid this? Firstly, Conor Eberbrown is a conscientious and well-informed composer and clarinetist who, despite the absence of a personal Jewish heritage, has immersed themselves in klezmer music from an early age. Upon hearing David Krakauer's performance of Osvaldo Golijov's Dreams and Prayers of Isaac the Blind, Brown became committed to not only pursuing klezmer clarinet performance, but specifically studying with Krakauer. In both regards, they have been successful and studied with Krakauer at Bard College. Conor's previous compositions feature traditional Jewish modal systems, fluency with characteristic ornamentation, and Conor's also a pretty amazing clarinetist. All of this established them as a klezmer expert. If we combine this understanding of Brown's klezmer background with the knowledge and historical information klezmerim often collaborated with non-Jewish musicians, and that non-Jewish musicians represent some of the most accomplished klezmerim in history, it seems that the Century Tune is a natural extension of a well-established cultural dialogue. In my preparation for the performance of Century Tune, I engaged established klezmer musicians Alicia Svigals, Steve Greenman, and Max Wolpert in private lessons. In addition to addressing specific klezmer ornamentation, aesthetics, and rhythmic approaches within the Century Tune, I posed the question to each, what it means for me to approach this music as a non-Jewish person. All individuals offered a similar response. If I approach this repertoire with intentionality, conviction, and knowledge, the issue of cultural appropriation is not really a concern. Though it's not enough to receive a pass from celebrated figures of a given tradition, their suggestion of considering klezmer with sincerity is a good one. I'm confident that an accurate, respectful, and sincere way to approach the interpretation of any music is to engage in a culturally immersive experience. This is complicated and asks performer to exist as a historian, anthropologist, sociologist, ethnomusicologist, technician, interpreter, in addition to the already demanding task of being a musician. The very notion may be crippling. In a practical sense, it is an unreasonable expectation for a performer to embody this approach for every piece of music they encounter. But I'm suggesting this mindset as a goal. It is entirely possible, if not indeed likely, that even the most well-intended product of these endeavors will be limited or faulty. However, even a faulty approach will yield some fruitful results. Rather than sidestepping this project altogether, an artist will be equipped with tools to approach the next project in an increasingly meaningful manner. Was this not the role of the klezmerim in the 20th and 19th centuries and earlier, when they were asked to perform a variety of music at a wedding celebration? These musicians had to understand the cultural context of their audience members, be able to draw upon a wide variety of dance forms, weave melody seamlessly to create an overall effect or emotion for an event. In this way, the role of the klezmerim is central to what it means to be a well-informed, empathetic artist today. Overall, this has contributed to a more robust understanding for me of what it means to be a collaborative artist. Previously, my definition of this buzzword was more or less relegated to the realm of performance. Someone who frequently rehearses and performs with a wide variety of musicians and perhaps works with composers on new works. At the conclusion of this project, I have found myself occupying the role of student, academic, researcher, ethnomusicologist, anthropologist, recording engineer, and cellist, all under the premise of developing an understanding of the components of the Century Tune. My new definition of collaborative artist includes anyone who does whatever it takes to approach a piece of art as intentionally, thoroughly, and as thoughtfully as possible, occupying as many roles as necessary for the fulfillment of that project. Read books to understand the background of a piece of music. Talk to members of a given community. Take lessons with experts in that genre. Learn how to use recording equipment to create multi-layer tracks, like in the Century Tune. Whatever the to-do list, place intentionality and empathy as a guide. This concludes the presentation portion of this recital. I'd like to again thank all committee members, teachers, and collaborators as listed on this last slide. I'm going to transition now to the performance of Conor Eberbrown's The Century Tune. So I'm going to stop the screen share and just take a moment to transition.
Thank you.
Thanks again for listening. That's the end of the presentation.
Very cool. Thanks, Jake.
Thank you, Jake.
Yeah, thank you.
It's tricky, managing not just the technological side of putting it together, but then just to perform it right now over Zoom, which is such a difficult medium, especially for a piece that has Steve Reich influences, and just to get a steady internet connection to help us with that. Anyway, but yeah, really enjoyed it. Really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Were there internet problems? Was it?
On my end, nothing serious at all. But when you have something that's so consistent, occasionally you notice a few lapses, and but anyway, yeah, I really, really enjoyed that. If my colleagues can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe we have a few minutes for Q&A. If anybody would like to jump in with any sort of, yeah, Professor Teitelbaum.
So there's so many wonderful things about all of this, Jake. And we about the presentation. My family are Galician Jews, so it's you know, I learned a lot, and you know, really enjoy learning a lot about this from hearing you speak. And I love the piece, and I love the way you played it. I'm going to be a good committee member though, and also fulfill my role as an ethnomusicologist by picking at something that I might have some criticism on.
Please.
Let's be productive for it. So at the very end, when you were talking about cultural appropriation, one of the reasons why I'm not a full adherent to the movement is that at times it prompts us to look at one set of insider-outsider statuses to the exclusion of others. One way of thinking of ourselves as being part of a community or expressive form, or being outside of it. And in this case, I certainly take to heart what you say and appreciate the intentions behind your wanting to be sensitive to your status as a non-Jew playing Jewish music. But I wonder if we're losing sight of the fact also that you're a classical musician, if I'm going to jump out and define you that way, playing folk music. And I wonder at times if that isn't more consequential here, and also perhaps a grander concern for klezmer. We see a lot of instances throughout Western art music where folk music is kind of brought in, and it usually, sometimes it's lovely, fantastic music, but it's seldom the same thing, right? Grieg is one of the classic examples that, you know, he writes amazing music, and that's, I play Scandinavian folk music, so that's my way of getting into this. Right, it's wonderful music, but in no way does it sound like Norwegian Hardangerfjella or something like that. Villa-Lobos has been thought of as being closer to some Brazilian art forms, but folk music forms. And you do a lot here to really study klezmer performers. But I wanted to give all this to you. There's not really a question mark at the end, but I wonder if we haven't overlooked that dynamic, because one of the dangers of cultural appropriation is representation, right? It's that somebody's art form or identity suddenly becomes the tool, or, you know, available and instrumentalized by other people. So I'll stop now. That was a long.
No, that's great. May I comment on that, or should we move on?
Please do.
That is something that absolutely came up in conversation with Conor, and there's been these online conversations about some elements that are perhaps missing from music education. There's this article that came out that was critical of Juilliard for that, and we were kind of talking about this article, and one of the ideas being floated is that classical musicians can have this idea that they can play anything because it's the hardest repertory, and if you can play classical, you can do anything. And I was realizing in the context of this piece that that's not at all the case. So this is really hard, doing these ornamentations and knowing when to do them, when not to do them, and how to sound in this And so that was a huge motivation behind pursuing those private lessons, and just being around people who sound like that and realizing that, like, no, I'm not at all really, I can maybe hold the cello, but I don't really have the equipment otherwise. And so that's a point really well taken.
Uh-huh. Cool. Something to think about. I still loved it, Jake. Yeah. I love all of it. So,
nice.
Can I ask you a quick question? Can I ask Jake just a really quickie? I'm sorry, yeah. David. I didn't mean to interrupt. Did you, I mean, I know Connor's not, you know, he's not Jewish, and I'm thinking of other people like that I know. Evan Chambers, a composer who's almost devoted his entire output to Irish folk music of many different decades, and he's not Irish. But that's sort of how, where he's sort of planted his flag as a composer. Did you, so I'm going to come right back to Connor now. Did you play through this, like you've performed for him, or he's sort of seen you put this together? I'm imagining the answer is yes, but I wanted to ask you how much Connor time you had while putting this together.
I will say more Connor time is ahead. I was pretty late in the game to getting the first half of this recorded. It just took me a long time to figure out how to do it, honestly. And so I have not yet, unless, I don't think Connor's in the room though, I invited him, but invited them, but I have not played the first half, but we definitely have worked quite a bit on the Jacques together.
Okay, so did you use Logic to do this, or did you just, or just some sequencer of some kind?
Yeah, all through just built-in GarageBand on my MacBook.
Oh, GarageBand. Oh, okay. That's, yeah, it's, yeah, it's free. It's freeware. Boom.
Yeah.
My other question was, and this is very, very detailed. I was watching the score go by as you were performing it. Thanks for sending that and the essay. I noticed that you gave your own sort of consistent flair. Again, you know, I know you're primarily, like Ben said, a classical musician, but you gave a consistent flair to the straight 16th notes. And you know, instead of filling the beat, you actually rushed the beat. And I'm wondering if that was conscious, or is that just a logistical thing for those, you know, for your sort of psychic, I guess, I don't know, I don't know what I'm trying to say, context as you're going through it. But instead of da 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 dum, it was da 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 da. Dumb, you know, right. And did he hear that, or does, you know, how does that square with you and with Connor?
So when I was working on this piece with someone like Alicia Svigals, for example, it was a really interesting experience because I sent her the score, but she's not primarily a note reader. And so a lot of our lesson was her just like, wait, no, let me try that again. Does it go like this? Can I, you know, and she, you know, she would play some of these melodies, and I just picked that up from her. Like whenever she would play 16th notes in the Jacques form, it was always compressed and it was always leading to the next beat. And I asked her about that. I was like, you know, why is the third beat like that? For example, in the opening, bum, 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 there are straight eighth notes, and she would play it as bum, 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 ba-dup. And I asked her why. And the answer was basically, that's just the way it is. And she had, I was like, well, you know, me being a, you know, DMA student, I'm like, well, tell me more. Like, why is it that, you know, why is it that way? And she just said, well, I think there's something to do with the dance form. Like they're lifting their leg at that time, and you're trying to like align the music with the dropping of the leg or something like that. But basically that's just the way it is. And so I would say that's something I picked up directly from her, as a way to emphasize the condensed third beat. But besides that, it's just something, it's like it's something aurally picked up.
So it's like a dialect. It's like a musical dialect.
I tried to do something similar with a lot of the triplets at the end of measures, like just condense them in a way so it's not spread out. I don't know exactly how, I have not specifically asked Connor if that's the way, but when I performed it in that style, they didn't seem to think that was problematic. And, you know, we have talked about the complexities of, you know, shortening that third beat, especially how to create that affect within my, I don't know how to do that on a GarageBand yet.
But, let me ask you, Max Wolpert, was he instructive on that too? Do you remember actually talking about folk music dialect in this context with him?
Yeah, Max was an interesting case. Max admitted that he's only a latecomer to Klezmer and has written, the reason I wanted to work with him is that he has written string quartets in Klezmer style. And so he has experience with string playing, with the ornamentation and also notation. And so we had a relatively short lesson in which we just went over the basic ornamentation. And then we had a conversation about his background with Jewish music and what that means to him. He's also non-Jewish, and so I was curious about what are you doing in this art form and why, that sort of thing.
Yeah. Cool. Hey, I got to tell you, bravo. I look at through that score and I my eyes roll back after how the tremendous challenge
Thank
to
you,
put Rick. That together, especially with those rhythms all written out like that. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So Jake, what are the next steps with this premiere?
Yeah, the next step will be a studio recording. That's the plan. Originally, this was going to be on the major project album, but just the timeline of things. I also think that the album as it is kind of long enough and kind of stands by itself. And so I'm considering a separate release in the summer with this and the other piece I mentioned briefly that I've commissioned, and maybe adding a third piece that's in some sort of folk traditional style. But I think there's quite a long road ahead in terms of really perfecting the performance of both parts of this composition. There'll be a process where Conor has this concept of making it sort of a spatial auditory experience and panning the different cello parts so it creates kind of a surround sonic effect. And so there'll be a lot more collaboration ahead with between myself and Conor and the recording engineer, really dialing this in. And so that's looking like it's going to be a late spring or early summer project. But and then once we have that, the high quality versions of cellos 2 through 10, I see no reason why this shouldn't be made public. And I'm thinking about doing something with making some sort of short video about, some of the ornamentation and some of my background with this piece, and making it available for other cellists to interact with. Because I think it's really a really cool piece, and it's not easy, but it presents a lot of interesting things that people are interested in.
Excellent. Yeah, it is a very cool piece. And also we have nothing really like it for cello, at least. So it's very appealing. And I think you're absolutely right that it can stand alone. It can, or, paired with your other commission. I think it will work out just fine, not being on your primary recording document. So wonderful. Well, we're past the 2 o'clock mark. I don't want people to run too far behind. Erica, did you have?
Jake, were you here when I think it was Topple Music came through and did a they did Hasidic program on the artist series, and then also Jeanette Sorrell, who runs Apollo's Fire out of Cleveland, they have this Sephardic journey, Wanderings of the Spanish Jews, which is also an interesting take on, she's done some Appalachian stuff as well, where she kind of delves into a genre of music. And so I was just still kind of mulling over this idea of appropriation and how, as classical musicians, I was also coaching a little, sort of, I would almost say it's like a, so they're little Spanish songs, these William Grant Still pieces that Sella Park is playing right now. And we were trying to kind of find a way into the language of articulation and all of that. And I would hate for her to not be able to play those songs because she's not got the background, because it's so good as classical players to, I think it expands so greatly our interpretive skills by actually exploring music that's really out of our training, you know, in sort of German and
right.
some French.
No, it's a great project. I hope she does that. I think for me, one thing that like the refinement of tone and intonation that we talk so much about is intonation is important, but it's not nearly the same. Like when I'm hearing klezmer musicians play, I don't know, there's something just, it's rustic in a very true sense of the word, you know, where it's just not, I don't think they've spent hours and hours crafting tone. It's more about like the application of the music, the intent of the music, the heart behind it, who's listening to it. And that's, for me, that's something really difficult to depart from because we've spent so much time cultivating that. But once you can, once you do, it's liberating in a certain way. I'm not saying I'm fully there, but.
Yeah, I was just curious, have you tried singing some of these gestures?
Yeah, quite a lot of singing, I find it hard to, it's different than singing like Western melodies where there's, you know,
yes.
Yeah, there's just so much more to it. I need to spend more time with just making that natural, I think.
I think even just this idea of the characters of grace notes and things like that, and when you're dealing in these different modes, there's a different kind of pull to them. Yeah. And I think you take it away from the cello, and then there's just this, I don't know, I think it's an interesting way of finding a kind of holistic approach to it rather than being, you know, the clarinet, you know, I've always, the klezmer clarinet is so interesting. And I for me, it was Goliath's air that got me really into, but that wasn't all Jewish inspired in that piece. But yeah, no, it's a really interesting, I thank you for sending us the link. I'm not grading this project, but I was really curious.
Yeah, no, thank you for tuning in. I appreciate that.
That's great.
All right, well, thank you, Jake. Really, really enjoyed your process with this, and I'm excited for the future of this, future performances and publishing of this piece.
Yeah.
Great. So I believe in less than 24 hours, tomorrow late morning is your exit interview. Is that correct?
Yeah, 11:30 is what I have. Is there anything that I should know to think about ahead of time, or I really am going into this with, I'm fine going into it with no information, but I'm just curious.
Well, you know, I think your committee will do our best to go through your recording document for sure, so we can talk more about that.
Cool.
And yeah, it's true that your repertoire project will fall after this exit interview, but or final oral. But I have no problem with that. So
great. Well, thank you all very much. It's been really fun putting this together.
Great. And then also thank you. I know you, this was just set up, but thanks for recording this. I would not be surprised if Professor Rhodes and Moline want to check out this as well. So
absolutely.
All right.
Well, thanks again. Also thanks Mom for tuning in.
Awesome. All right, everybody, have a great day.
All right. You take care.
Have a great day. Thank you, Jade. Congrats.
Bye.
Bye.